Aloha mai kākou. Aloha kakahiaka. Simply meaning good morning and welcome to all. If you are joining us here for the first time, we would love to aloha you right after this service. Yes, welcome you if you are joining us for the first time. If you are joining us live, would you please feel free to share the link. With that being said, I pray you had a blessed week. If you're going through a rough season right now, praise the Lord. And the reason I say that, I don't say that to not be sensitive of your situation. Praise the Lord for the tech team, and thank you, Lord, that the tech team, that's my wife. Thank you, Jesus. And I don't want to be insensitive when I say if you're going through a rough season, good. But what I want to say through that your hardship should drive you to Jesus. And God will use those things to draw you completely to Him. And that's what really matters. So this morning, I just want to encourage you as we prepare our hearts for worship. Yeah. With a scripture that comes from Philippians chapter 4. It's a little lengthy. It's from verses 6 to 9. But as I read this over you, if you want to close your eyes and just meditate on this, on the word, then do that. If you come in with a heavy heart, with everything that's really holding you down and stopping you from really hearing God, lay that right now at His feet. Philippians 4, 6 to 9 says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Oloy, listen right here. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, and whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I pray that you have been encouraged by that word this morning. I pray that you have come to hear the word this morning. I pray that you will receive His word this morning. So will you please stand with me as we worship our one and only true King, Jesus. Have a blessed service.
You hear us when we shout your name. grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name.
High and lifted up. Good morning. In this time of generosity, first we just like to welcome Dr. Robert Miller, who is with us here this morning. He's joining us from the HPBC, and if you've been hearing that a lot, it's because they have really been a huge support for us in these past weeks, right? And it's been great for us. The love and support that they have shown us is just huge. And with that, more information will be coming out soon. But just the encouragement and just to keep you informed in that, they have been such a support for us as we navigate and work through this transition. And so it's great to have Dr. Robert here this week. With that as well, Connie and I also were able to meet with a group from the Acts 29, Pastor James Shiroma and Matt Dirks, and a bunch of other guys. And so it was really good for us to meet them. And just for me, it's just been like almost overwhelming. I mean, this is organizations and churches all throughout the state. I mean, we're talking about over a dozen churches that this is in connection with that have been reaching out to us as we go through this. And it's just such an encouragement to Connie and I especially. And we want to extend that to you so that you know and you keep it informed in what's going on. Because there's a lot of people that are praying for you, praying for Ohana Church. And there's a lot of people that are going to war for us, that are supporting us and helping us. And so, just to move on, I just wanted to share that with you, and it's been huge. It's really been huge. And the greatest thing about that is not because of who we are or where we are or anything like that, but the first and foremost reason is because of the common bond that we have, and that is Christ. Amen? So, especially with Dr. Robert Miller, I've just met him a few weeks ago. With a lot of those guys that we met with Acts 29, I met them that day. But just to see that, again, it's not because of me, it's not because of Connie, it's not because of you or Ohana Church or Hilo. It's because of God. So, with that, let me pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, just come before you with so much thankfulness. God, so much that you have done for us, are doing today, and will continue to do tomorrow. God, from the creation to our salvation, to all the little ways that you work in us and for Ohana Church, God, we are so thankful. And Lord, we just pray, God, as different things come up and as we go through different things and different changes, God, we pray that our minds, our hearts, our eyes would be set on you. God, remind us, you're the creator of the world. All of our biggest problems are small time to you. You hold us in the palm of your hand. You are the sovereign ruler, creator, sustainer. And so God, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. And Lord, in this time of generosity, God, we pray for the finances, the money that comes into Ohana Church, may it simply go through Ohana Church. May you bless it and multiply it to your will. And God, may it go out to reach the farthest reaches of the world so that more would come to know you. I pray this in your name. Amen. So just in that really quick, the ways that you can give here at Ohana Church, you can go on our website at ohanachurch.com/give. You can drop it in the back, and you can also text the amount to 84321. And I just wanted to encourage you not to give because, like, we need your money or something like that, but give because God gave. And God gave far more than we could ever give. Amen? And in the giving, it's just a representation of the gratitude, but more than that, it makes us dependent on Him, which is where we need to be. So just in that encouragement, and so as we continue now in worship, go ahead and stand with me and we'll continue.
My mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. Drenched in tears, they laid Him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh,
Jesus will return. It's His second coming. Paul wrote this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54 through 57. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin. and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for your cross, your resurrection, your propitiation.
It's meant to be opened, explored, pursued. It's made to be read, reread, applied, and used. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, with wisdom, life-changing, to lead us on. It's made for guidance, to teach us His ways, showing what's true, right, and worthy of praise. It's meant to be hidden deep in our hearts, daily examined as the morning starts. No greater glimpse of God do we have, a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
Amen. Thank you, worship team. Appreciate that. That was a great time of worship. And Aloha, Ohana Church, it's a privilege to be with you and to bring God's word. 33 years ago, God sent this city boy to a remote place in North Kohala to plant a church, which is now Kohala Baptist Church. And so this is a very special place for me, and it's always a joy to come back and to see what God is doing in our midst. I now, as you heard, serve on Oahu with Chris Martin. Chris has been preaching here, as you know, in the last few weeks. And so we serve 160 churches across the Pacific, and we see God at work in various settings. And so think about it this way. You're part of a network of churches that are proclaiming the gospel throughout the Hawaiian Islands and across the Pacific Rim. And so that's exciting, and it's great to partner with you. Now, as much as we've been seeing God at work all around us, I think we would agree that these past few years have been challenging for many of us. A lot of things going on. In fact, we are still feeling the effects of the changes that are going on around us. The pandemic and world events have changed life as we know it. Inflation continues to bring stress on our families. And church life has even changed. Maybe not here, but it has in many other congregations. And so for many, these are stressful times. And I would imagine some of you are going through some difficult times, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. And so this begs the question, how do we find peace in this chaos? How do we find peace in this chaos? Fortunately, God offers us a peace that passes all understanding. In other words, God can comfort and assure his people in a way that is beyond comprehension. Now, if God is the one who brings peace, and he does in our life, then what part do we have in obtaining this peace so we can live in such a way that God is honored? Well, we can make choices that foster peace, right? We also know that we can make choices that add to our anxiety. Sometimes we do that. Well, this morning, let's look to the Bible for instruction. And you can follow along in your Bibles in Philippians 4, 4 through 13. Brother Connie read some of that, but I'm going to read the entire passage and repeat some of what he said. But it's always good to hear God's word. So I'm in Philippians chapter 4, starting in verse 4. Keep in mind, Paul the Apostle is the writer of this book, and through the leading of the Holy Spirit. And here's what he says. Rejoice in the Lord always, and I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. So do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Verse 10. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for the authority of your word and the privilege that we have to sit under it and to be taught. We ask, Lord, that you would give us ears to hear and a sensitive heart to respond. We pray that you would teach us and that we would take your word and obey it in our life. Again, we thank you and we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, let's look at three things that we can do to find peace in a season of uncertainty and anxiety. And you'll see that listed on the PowerPoint. The first choice, which I think is essential, is that we choose to rejoice during anxious times. We choose to rejoice during anxious times. Now, if we look at Acts 16, when Paul visited Philippi, we read that it didn't take long for him to experience adversity in his life, in his ministry. He and Silas, you may recall, were arrested. They were stripped of their clothes and brutally beaten. And when they regained consciousness, they were put in jail. And so with their wounds, the dirty prison, and their feet in stocks, I think we would agree that this was the making of a bad day. Sometimes we have those kind of days. But what was the reaction to this bad day? What was the reaction? Scripture says that at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praise to God as other prisoners were listening. Now, some might find this very unusual. Rather than complaining in the corner of their cell of how life was difficult or shaking their fist at God, what are they doing? They are praising him. You see, they chose to be joyful in a time when most would be fearful or anxious. This was a conscious decision on their part to believe that all was well. Why? Because the Lord was with them. Now, do you see the connection between what happened to Paul in Philippi on his first visit and what he wrote here several years later? He wrote here, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. And I believe this is more than wishful thinking or some form of denial. These are words that Paul the Apostle lived by. Now for us today, this might not be our natural reaction during adversity. I'll be honest with you, I know my reactions are often based on my mood. And if I'm having a bad day, I will react a certain way, or if I've had a past experience that gives me a certain sense of what might happen. You can ask my wife. I'm not always rejoicing in the Lord. The writer of Hebrews says, through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise, that is the fruit of the lips that acknowledge his name. Friends, we do have a choice. We do have a choice to pause, to trust God, and to tell him that we love him in prayer and song. We have that choice. Some of you might remember Chuck Swindoll, a well-known pastor. He tells a story of a couple who had been to a Bible conference. I found this an interesting story. The theme of the conference was looking unto Jesus. The emphasis was on keeping your eyes on Jesus no matter what happens and rejoicing in all things. Well, when the conference was over, the couple got in their car and they headed home across several states. On their way home, late at night, they got into a car accident. The older gentleman avoided an oncoming car and drove his car into a ditch. Now remember, he and his wife just committed themselves to fully follow the Lord. And so they quickly climbed out of the wrecked car, stood on top of the car, and began singing, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." People stopped and gathered at the bridge to see if they were okay. The couple also sang the entire doxology, and the policeman at the scene had his hat over his heart. When they finished singing, the husband stood on top, or the husband looked up to the crowd, and he said, "You folks might have wondered why I called this meeting today." And then he told them about Christ while on top of his car in the ravine. Now, some might say that he was crazy, but he was just doing what he believed honored God. You see, we constantly make choices on how we will approach our day. You see, whether we are in a car accident, whether we're battling a disease or quarantine, or struggling to make ends meet, no matter how difficult or painful our circumstances, we have the choice to interpret our situation differently. And so here's the choice. We can worry, which most of us are good at, or we can believe God's promises. Joy and peace come when we focus on Christ and his promises. And so Paul says, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Now, that word rejoice here is an action verb. It isn't a happy motion that we conjure up within us. Rejoicing is expressing our gratitude for God's grace in our life. You know, one thing God has given us to battle anxiety is prayer. You see, prayer helps us to release that anxiety in our life to the Lord Jesus Christ. This means we don't have to carry all those burdens alone. We can cast our cares on him, the scripture tells us, because he cares for us. Now, prayer is more than thinking about your burdens. That's called worry. Prayer is actually presenting your request to God. You see, friends, prayer allows you to give your burdens to the Lord Jesus Christ. And like you, I struggle with worry, but I have a practice that helps me get through it. I keep a running list of all the things that make me anxious, the big things and the small things that bring me stress are on this list. And then I systematically give it to the Lord in prayer and begin to sense a renewed peace. You know, friends, it's kind of hard to explain, but God keeps his promises. He keeps his promises to his word. You see, we don't have to carry a heavy burden. We don't have to carry a heavy load. I don't. You don't. God promises that if you present your request to him, listen carefully, he will give you peace and he will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. So today we can rejoice in times of anxiety. And some of you are going through some anxious times right now. There's another thing I see in this passage that I think requires some attention, and that is to choose thoughts that are wholesome. To choose thoughts that are wholesome. When I was a teenager, before I became a Christian, I was introduced to Transcendental Meditation, or TM. TM is a practice of Hinduism where you transcend into a place of peace. In TM, you are taught to sit in a quiet place and to repeat an assigned mantra. And so they teach that if you concentrate on your mantra, you free your mind and you somehow calm yourself. Now, this kind of meditation is actually a way of escape. Whereas with biblical meditation, you focus more on God's word. Well, my parents, who were not believers at the time, thought that this might be good for our family. It was not, but I had to follow them. However, out of this experience, I've observed a few things. First, people will do almost anything to alleviate stress. Have you noticed that? Have you noticed they will do almost anything, even foolish things? Second, although most people do not practice TM, I believe many repeat mantras to themselves. Now, what do I mean by this? That we often recall experiences from the past and we play it over and over again in our mind. For example, perhaps you were traumatized in the past and you find yourself replaying that incident in your mind. Or maybe you were deeply hurt or embarrassed years ago and your mind still brings up that event and it's painful. Or you might know someone who has been deeply hurt and their unspoken mantra is never trust anyone. And then there are those who dwell on impure thoughts or they let their mind wander to dark places. And I think the isolation caused by the pandemic didn't help us. Whatever the case, we carry mantras with us that we replay over and over again, and we don't realize how these thoughts that we have control our lives. When the Israelites wandered in the desert, they constantly complained about the food, wanting to go back to Egypt. You see, they were angry and they were ungrateful, and this complaining became a regular pattern that was hard for them to break. Well, God, who knows us, says to fill our mind with the things that are excellent and praiseworthy. Proverbs 23:7 says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. So instead of filling our mind with discouraging thoughts or dark thoughts, God offers better options. So today, think about it. We can fill our thoughts with God's cleansing word. And that's why we encourage people to read the word regularly. We can delight in the Lord and meditate on his goodness. He's constantly good to us. We can dwell on the hopeful future promised by Christ. If you're a follower of Christ, you have a reward waiting for you. Colossians 3:16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing praises and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. In other words, we need to train our minds to go where God is honored and others are encouraged. 2 Corinthians 10:5 talks about taking captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. You say, why? Because if we're not careful, our thoughts can get out of control and we can camp out in areas that are very dark. We can dwell on things that paralyze us. I've seen it. And I really believe exercising self-control over our thoughts can be one of the hardest things to do, one of the hardest battles. Why? Because we allow our thoughts to wander. We allow our thoughts to wander, and there's no accountability where our mind goes. And so one moment we're thinking about something we shouldn't, another moment we're in something else. You see, we can have impure thoughts without even someone else knowing about it, right? For example, we can fixate on retaliation. We can be critical of others. We can lust and we can still hide all of this from others and do a good job of it. Look, Paul gives us two practical words of advice in verse 8. First, dwell on things that are true, noble, right, and pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, and praiseworthy. In other words, let your mind camp out on things that are wholesome. Think about things that cause you in your life to want to praise the Lord. You know, sometimes when I'm tempted to be critical of others or hold on to discouraging thoughts, I almost have to tell myself, don't go there. Don't go there. You see, these last 3 years have been tough years for many of us. But this year can be the year we make more of an effort to redirect those negative thoughts to God-honoring thoughts. It takes discipline, right? Because those negative thoughts, those impure thoughts can just come like that. Paul's second advice is whatever you've learned and put into practice. And so growing Christians aren't just inspired by a sermon or a great Bible study. They put it into practice. Growing Christians put into practice what they learn. They are doers, not just hearers. And when we obey God's word, listen to this, we see changes in our thought patterns and we see changes in our attitude. And so we can choose thoughts that are wholesome during anxious seasons. And for some of us, this is an anxious season. There's one last point I want to make, and that is to choose contentment in whatever circumstances. Choose contentment in whatever circumstances. Paul the Apostle lived during times of need and times of plenty. As you know, he was a tent maker and a missionary, and he lived through lean years, but he also lived through years of abundance. Whatever his circumstance, Paul learned to be content, and he says it here in the text. Now, if we compare our lives to Paul's day, I think it's safe to say that most of us are much better off than he was. We have a roof over our head. We have running water. Our homes are powered for lights and appliances. Our pantries and refrigerators are full of food. Many of us have our own vehicles. And this alone is more than what most people have around the world. America is one of the richest countries, yet, have you noticed, we're not happy. We're not happy. We take more medication for our fears and worries than any other country in the world. We want more, and we are stressed out more, and I believe a big reason for this is that we have not learned to be content. You see, if you're not content now, at this point in your life, you'll probably not be content 5 years from now. Because there are always more to acquire, right? There's always more to strive after. There's always more to fret over in your life. When you were younger, do you remember chasing butterflies with a net? Remember that? It's never easy to catch a butterfly, right? Contentment and happiness are sometimes like butterflies. The more you chase them, the more they fly away and they hide. Let me ask you, are you truly content with what you've been provided? 1 Timothy 6:6 says, godliness with contentment is great gain. And so if you're seeking God and you're content with what he has provided you, you, think about it, are way ahead of the game. Bill Gothard said, contentment is realizing that God has already provided everything you need for your present happiness. Charles Spurgeon, the great preacher, said, it is not how much you have, but how much you enjoy that makes happiness. And Jesus said, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Are you content with what you already have? Once a rich businessman, disturbed to find a fisherman sitting idly by his boat, asked, why aren't you out there fishing? Because I've already caught enough fish for today, was the reply. Well, why don't you catch more fish than you need? Asked the rich man. Now, why would I do that? You could earn more money, buy a bigger boat so you can go deeper and catch more fish and then make more money. Soon you have a fleet of boats and be rich just like me. Then what would I do? Asked the fisherman. Well, you could sit down and enjoy life. What do you think I'm doing now? The fisherman replied. Thank God we can sit down and enjoy life now. Nothing's stopping you from doing that. We can choose contentment in every circumstance. And if, friends, if you've been given much, share it with others. If times are tough in your family, Give thanks for what you do have. Give thanks for what you do have. Deep contentment comes from knowing a sovereign God is in control. And when we trust God, we can say with confidence, as Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. You know, as we continue to face stressful times and other hardships in life, we don't have to search far and wide to find peace and contentment. Praise the Lord. And it's not found in some vacation that you're saving up for. It's not found in retirement. Some of you are approaching retirement or the latest self-help book. God is the one that offers peace. God offers peace, and nothing compares to the peace that he offers those that seek him. You see, with God's help, we can put these principles into practice. And when we do, God is glorified in our life. God is glorified in life. Now, before I close this message, it's important that you realize that genuine peace begins with a person and not a formula or a person or a program. And this person, of course, is the Lord Jesus Christ. And as I said earlier, we don't acquire peace by somehow emptying our minds, and it doesn't come when we try real harder on our own strength. And yes, there are a lot of substitutes for genuine joy and contentment. God's peace begins with a relationship with God's only Son. It begins with a right relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And a right relationship with God comes when we acknowledge our need for Christ and turn from our sin. You see, friends, God sent his Son to die on the cross to pay for our sin. Because we could not pay for our sin, Jesus took on our sin and he covered it with his shed blood. And when we believe in Christ and what he did on the cross for us, for our sins, we're saved from sin and death and we are forgiven. And when we are made right with God, we can be made right with others. So as we prepare to close, here's a question for you. Are you in right relationship with God this morning? Are you in right relationship with others? Is there anything you need to clear up? And I invite you to call on the Lord for help this morning. In a moment, as I pray, you can also talk to God and bring any concerns to him. And God will hear you. He will hear you and he will answer you and he will meet you where you're at if you're genuinely seeking him. And if you have questions about this message or questions about following Jesus or you need prayer, you're invited to come during the response time, or you can see me or one of the elders after the service. We want to respond as God's Spirit is leading us. Let's join together in a word of prayer. As we pray, the worship team can make their way up front. Father, we thank you for the authority of your word. We know, if we're honest, we've walked through seasons of anxiety, through stressful times. There are times when we felt like it was unbearable. There are times when we were overwhelmed, whether it was relational issues or financial issues. Father, we were reminded this morning that peace begins with you on the cross. So, Lord, help us to recall this scripture. Help us to make right choices in our life. Forgive us, Lord, when we make choices that are selfish or fearful choices that do not reflect your promises. And Lord, we also ask that you would teach us to pray. Oh Lord, forgive us for trying to figure things out in our own strength. Teach us to pray. We want to glorify you in our life. I pray for Ohana Church. I pray you would continue to sustain her as you bless her, that this congregation would be a lighthouse in the community, that their words and their actions and their faith in you might be a testimony to those in Hilo and beyond. And So, Lord, thank you for that. Thank you that we can lean upon you. So now, as we take some time to respond, Father, if there's anyone here that needs prayer, encouragement, or a word of instruction, I pray that they would have the courage to come forward and to share their burden with others who can support them through this time. We thank you again, Lord, and we pray that you would be glorified this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus hanging on that tree. As we sing this song together. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Righteousness for me stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood,
your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me. Stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. What can wash away your sin? What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can wash us pure as snow?
What can wash us pure as snow? Welcome as the friends of God. Nothing but your blood. Nothing but your blood.
Your cross, your cross testifies in grace, tells of the Father's heart, make a way for us. And boldly we approach, not by earthly confidence, it's only by your blood. Your cross testifies,
your cross testifies in grace, tells of the Father's heart, to make a way for us. Now boldly we approach, not by earthly confidence, it's only by your blood.
For the blood, sing this with me. We praise you for the blood. We praise you for the blood.
We praise you for the blood.
Nothing but your blood.
Nothing but your blood, King Jesus.
We lay our burdens at your feet, Jesus. All our anxiety we cast on you. Teach us how to repent. Teach us how to lay down all of our burdens and to confess to you. We can confess to you. 1 John 1 verse 9. You are righteous and just to forgive us of all our trespasses, all of our sin, all of our iniquity. There's nothing we can hide from you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that forgiveness.
God. It has been an awesome now going on 4 weeks. Amen. So blessed by the message that God has brought. Mahalo again, Dr. Robert. I was about to say he's coming back next week, but no, that's not going to be the case. Surely touched by the message. As there's three things that was brought out in this message, and I just want to bring that back again. You know, it's something that you can mock and take with you, not just during this week, but hopefully through the rest of your life and whatever situation that you may battle. Before I say anything in that vein, I want to say, when we say that God is good, yes, all the time, but I pray, and it says nothing to anybody that just said that, but I pray that our response wouldn't be so casual. I pray that as we focus on the things that we think about, the things that are true, the things that are noble, the things that are just, that we meditate on when we say that God is good, what does that really mean? Amen? So in the process of that, I just want to say this. So the three things that really stood out, the points. Choose to rejoice during anxious times. Can I be honest with you? Oh, anxiety is hard and wide for me. You know, for me and Ian, this last 4 weeks or during the transition. But what's been great on top of that is there is no other place for me to be, no other place for me to go but to the foot of God. Because this is not about Ohana Church. It's a bigger picture. It's about God. It's about His kingdom. It's about His glory. And it's not just about how Ian and I lead. What are we all doing in our personal lives? And what is God calling you? And how is God calling you to lead? So in that, we can get caught up into the what we see, the visions of what we see, but I pray that your visions would align with God's. And that's where the anxiety comes for me. God, is it you? Is it me? You know? So to add to that, we see that in the word that they were praying and that they were singing, that they praised God. I want to add to that, complain and remain, praise and be raised. Cry about it. Keep sniveling about your situation. What you think going to happen? You're only going to get deeper in your own self, deeper in the problem. Let's go after the solution. Let's go after God. Choose thoughts that are wholesome. How do we do that? Spend time in God's word. Spend time with God's people. You become your surroundings. You want to keep crying? Spend time with one complainer. You like move forward? Spend time with somebody who keeps praising. Somebody who's not just positive. Not just positive words. Not just positive thoughts. But their lifestyle aligns with God. And finally, this one was so honorable for me. Choose contentment in whatever. What is whatever? Whatever. Anything. Any situation. Choose contentment in whatever circumstances. Learn to be grateful for what you have, not for what you don't have. And I'll close with this. If you that guy, or you that wahine, asking God for the millions of dollars, be ready, don't catch feelings, but here's the truth. If you cannot steward $1, four quarters, what make you think, you right there, you looking at me, what make you think that God should give you a million? Learn to be grateful for what you have. Ask God to steward what you have. I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about your time. If you're like me, busy, busy, busy. Well, God, you know what? When guys say one day at a time, if you are that one day at a time kind of guy, please teach me how to do that. Because 24 hours is too long for me. I get in trouble in 2 seconds. But it's asking God, coming before God, God, how do I steward my time? How do I steward my relationship that it would look like you and not like me? Because me, I am the problem. So in all of this, and I say all of this in love, go to God for your answers. Spend your time with God's Ohana. When you don't want to spend time with God's Ohana, that's the red flags. Because if you don't want to spend time with God's Ohana, then where are you spending your time? Simple as that. We here at Ohana Church, once again, if you just came for the first time today, we would like to take some time. Yes, mahalo for your time for coming. We want to love you after. And you know that kind of, that big guy in the back there? That humble bear back there, that's my brother-in-law, Paula. He's passing out some cookies, so please grab some. And just thank you for you guys' time today. Thank you for allowing God to speak to you. What an awesome message again, Dr. Robert. Babe, please put the how to give on the top. So once again, to remind you, these are ways to give. You can give right here at 1967 Kinoole Street on your way out. Once again, that big somewhere, that tall handsome guy in the back who's giving out the cookies. He has the bowl. That you can, you know, you can put your kala, or put your gifts in there. And then you can do it. Let me turn around. That's too far for me. You can do the PayPal at Ohana Church and the Church Center app and text 84321 and the amount. See, usually all of that gets done in the generosity time. I guess God is trying to tell me, okay, Connie, you better get up with your game. But praise God. We love you all. If you want to spend some time, you need some prayers, you just want to talk and be transparent about whatever. This is God's house. It's not Ohana Church. It's for God, for God's reasons. We pray that we see you back next week. Have a blessed week and mahalo.